the profit has to be reasonable, and it has to be the drug has to be accessible to all. Now see, and this is not a hidden fact. This is a very open secret that the prices are, the profit margin is going as high as 79%. So unless you have a price cap, how can you make this accessible to everybody? And the price cap is only on the national list of essential medicines. That cost, that is only around 12%. And with this price cap, the sales have increased. They have not decreased. In spite of all the hue and cry, the sales have increased. The exports of the medicines have increased. So we don't see any adverse effect of this drug price control order. We are also trying to address the industry concerns, and Niti Aayog is already on the job. We are trying to fix a pharma index, like there will be some indexation, and that formula is being worked out. There are some suggestions that based on your the prevalence of the disease, like the disease burden, the highest disease burden could be placed under the essential list of medicines under the vital category. So that will come under price cap. So a lot of things are going on, and we are trying to address the industry concerns also. The fact again remains, let's say for example, when I am buying for the entire country, I am placing a rate contract. Statewide, the rate contracts are there. Do you know that in the rate contracts, we get price discounts of as low, as high as 60 to 80% sometimes. So now if there is not enough margin, how I am getting that discount? Now tell me, if I am having an RC, how am I getting a discount of 60 to 80%? So there is enough profit margin still, even I have, we have capped the price, still we are getting this kind of discount. So how it is possible? What there is a set formula for the price control. We take the average of all the players, top to bottom, and then divide, take the average. So then we have an average price. On the average price, then we put 16%. So that is how the price control runs. I mean, that is the basic thing that we do, and that too not for the innovative devices. For the new devices, it is a five-year period is there. We don't touch them. So, of course, we are trying to address the situation.
Niti Aayog people, I mean, I'm thankful to them that they have agreed that they will give us the money in 15 days. We don't want that this scheme should die like RSBY or Mamta scheme or in other states where schemes have died.
And I firmly believe, at least for the Indian setting, Tata is an excellent model for providing both high quality and affordable healthcare. So quality comes first. You know, the best chance of treating a cancer is the first time. You cannot treat it once it comes back. So Tata had the first PET CT machine in India. It has a second proton therapy unit in India. We are completely paperless. We have robotic surgery. So everything which is best is available in Tata. Apart from quality, you know, it's the same principle which Dr. Deshpande talked about, and we are from the same stable. It's about cross-subsidization. So in Tata, we have around 60% general category and 40% private category patients. Even amongst the general category, around 20% are those below the poverty line per capita basis or those having catastrophic healthcare expenditure. And these are provided services at almost free of cost. The other 40% are provided around 20% of what the hospital cost is. This is for the general category. For the private category, there's a 5 to 50% markup depending on, you know, whether they're deluxe, super deluxe, foreign national, etc. And the important thing is that the patient decides what category he or she wants to be. So in fact, the patient can shift category. So patient can start in the private category and later on he or she can say that I don't think I can afford this any longer and shift to a government category, a general category. But this is sort of the ratio we have realized is how it comes to us over years. And so it's, you know, sort of like I'm flying from Bombay to Delhi. Someone comes economy, someone comes business, someone comes first class. But everyone reaches a destination safely, which is what is the main thing for a patient. So how do we attract private patients who are affording private quality healthcare to come to Tata? One thing, of course, is the quality of infrastructure that we have. Second is the quality of doctors that we have. I think the biggest problem with public hospitals is because the remuneration is so low, anyone who is worth his salt will end up moving or being forced to move into the private sector simply because the package is, there's too much discrepancy. What Tata does is it gives a small share of the private income back to the doctors. So that makes our packages slightly better, slightly more competitive, and it then retains, you know, public-spirited doctors in the Tata domain. And given, you know, the quality of doctors and the quality of infrastructure, then we are able to ensure that even the private category patients come to us. I think one main reason for this nowadays is that, you know, patients trust us. As Tata doctors, we are not allowed private practice, so we don't have any conflicts of interest. So if we tell them something, it is in their interest. It is for no other reason. Also, we have very evidence-based, flowchart-based guidelines on how to manage every cancer. And in fact, a very robust QA/QC process so that any deviation from these guidelines is actually checked. So having all of this really helps in creating a model which works for both categories very well.
The patient does not have a choice because we have only one Tata. We do not have those models across the country. There are a few islands of exception which are providing very good high-quality services, but in general, patients do not have a voice. They just walk into a trap when they go to a hospital, and then they do not know what is happening after that because they walk into a system where there is no transparency, and I'm saying this upfront. Belonging to a family full of doctors, I'm saying this upfront. Now, having said that, I'll also say one more thing. We are working in a very broken healthcare system. It's not one person, one part of the system that is at fault. Everything needs to fall into place if the healthcare system has to work. Unfortunately, what is happening is we are shooting in the dark, hoping that we will hit the villain. And when there is light, wherever the arrow has gone and whoever it has hit, we have declared a villain. And then we have made a big hue and cry of that and glorified the whole thing, saying, look, we caught the villain and now we have a solution to it. So the first thing is, if statistics are to be believed, and if patient is spending, you know, out of pocket for drugs at 70% of medical expenses, why did we reach that place? What brought us to that position? Why is the patient spending 70% for drugs as out of pocket? Is there a root cause analysis for that which really tells us, you know, what is happening behind it? The second is, you know, when a patient goes to any healthcare provider, and I'm not saying that they have to be an inpatient, even if they go to a standalone doctor, what is it the patient is looking for? One is access. So do I have a healthcare provider who knows what my problem is and is able to diagnose and give me the right solution? Then the medicine will work if there is a price control that's going to give me a miracle cure. Do I have a facility? If the doctor wants an aid by means of diagnostics, do I have access to those diagnostics so that, you know, I'm able to provide those reports to the doctor to be able to prescribe the right medicines? We haven't addressed that problem at all. And then if I'm not an OPD case, if I need to be an inpatient case, do I have access to a hospital within the right time frame so that I'm able to reach, you know, well within the parameters of getting good quality care? So you might reduce the price of all the drugs in the world, but if I'm sitting in a remote village with no facility where I can reach a person, within the golden period for a heart attack, I will still die. So I'm not really addressing the problem by reducing prices. The second is quality. How are we measuring quality? NABH is voluntary. How many hospitals are really accredited? And who is monitoring that quality? And then you have that once in 3 years. What is happening in those 3 years? How many hospitals are actually reporting adverse drug events? How much of that is public data? And how many patients really know how to choose a hospital based on those parameters? Nothing is known. Safety. How much are we compromising on safety? And what are the, you know, golden standards for safety that hospitals are following? You might, you know, reduce the drug price to zero and say everything will be free of cost. But if you do not have quality and safety, you're reaching nowhere. And the third is patient outcomes. Who asks the patient what do they want? Everybody decides on behalf of the patient sitting on the other side of the fence, forgetting that they would be a patient one day. And many of us who are professionally doctors ourselves have gone through that when we go to hospitals, and then we realize how little control we have. Nobody asks us, do we want that procedure? Nobody asks that, is there an alternative available? Nobody asks that, is there something else that you would like to do, you know, if you do not want this procedure? Nobody asks. So you have to bring the patient to the center of the decision-making process, whether it is for the treatment choices or for the policy choices. Only then we will be able to mend the healthcare system, not shooting in the dark.
Today, when we talk about healthcare for all, we should also remember it should be quality healthcare for all. Because the government, as well as private, the corporates, fight tooth and nail with us to get a best price. But then the question comes whether they could provide a quality healthcare to the masses, to the people they are serving or not. The question can come to your mind, yes, government is giving a free treatment. Why? That is not possible. But sorry to state, say that there are no quality professionals to run those equipments. After government procured these equipments, you can visit to any district or subdivision hospitals, they are lying idle. And in case of privates or the corporates, the price is not a quality, the price is exorbitant in some cases. So when there is a glaring example of how sustainability can be attained or the profitability can be earned, we should follow that process. Because today, 5.2 billion is the medical device market. And by 2025, it will touch 50 billion. And this 50 billion will be possible when this quality healthcare will reach to the masses.
Once I called a call from Police Commissioner of Mumbai, Mr. Sivanandam, who is from also Coimbatore. I was shocked what crime I did, he is calling. I went to his office, he showed me a list of tests, and he told me, can you do this test? Yes, I can do. I imagined in a 5-star hospital, it is 1,000 rupees. Any laboratory would quote 300 rupees. And I thought I will quote 100 rupees. He told, I will give you only 50 rupees. Can you do it? In a fear, I agreed I will do it. Because sitting in front of a police commissioner, and I am in Mumbai, so in fear, I agreed. Mind you, 50,000 police we had screened in 50 rupees, and we made 50% margin even in that because of that 50,000 number. What I am coming to tell you is, there is no company on this earth which is closed down because they have priced it low. All companies have closed down, if you study, they priced it high, still they could not control the cost. So I am of that opinion. Laboratory test means all tests don't have the same profitability comfort. A hospital means they don't have profitability comfort in every segment. It is a mixture of so many things. In fact, if you look at one of the tests, a 5-star hospital is charging 1,000 times. But it is not seen in the balance sheet. In a listed company's balance sheet, 15-18% EBITDA appears to be too challenging. So they have their own woes, they have their own challenges. Coming to country, it's a pyramid of 10 slices. What is the topmost slice and what is the rest of the middle of the pyramid are totally different. Rich cannot go, rich will not go where poor goes, and poor cannot go where the rich goes. And country is going to continue with the two, Bharat and India. And acche din aane wale hain. So only when the per capita income goes up, as Dr. Monga told, packages will become better. Packages cannot be made better until the per capita income goes up. So everything is possible. Only thing is everybody should believe it is possible and get in there. And I'm pretty sure. And price controls will not work. But the business pressures will work.
India's healthcare industry is one of the fastest growing sectors, and in the next 10 years, it is likely to reach $275 billion. With growing consumer needs for high-end diagnostics, improved medical quality and precision, the capital investment in the sector has grown multifold. The sector in India is well diversified, full of opportunities. Medical tourism is growing at 20-25%. Standard Chartered Bank is proud to be partner in this growth with our specialized products to cater to your needs for effective collections and payments. We're focused on helping your business by providing bespoke solutions using our expertise developed over the years and across markets. We have a legacy of 160 years in India.